como que haces nada en cortes y cosas así, no. Es muy chulo con un tótico. Asia comes with Guinness. He or she presents with myriads of complaints, such as, I've been experiencing a spinning sensation of my head for the past few months with getting up from bed. I feel like I'm on a rocking boat. I fall down a lot and my feet feel like rubber. The room is rotating, I vomited 5 times, I'm not able to get up. And sometimes there's a roar, severe dizziness for half an hour. My ears are so blocked I cannot hear. So, but among all these, the most common complaint that we hear is gerarchy. So what is all that? How do we go about for a patient who presents like this? So what is vertigo? Vertigo is an abnormal sense of motion in the absence of motion or when the motion is sensed inaccurately. So when it is spinning, it's usually of the inner ear origin. This is not a disease but a symptom. So vertigo is a symptom. Why are we so concerned about vertigo, giddiness, dizziness? Because approximately 30% of the patients experience it, of which 80% seek medical care, out of which 25% are true vertigo. And giddiness is one of the most common principal complaints, so it's better that we know how to differentiate between vertigo, neurological disorders, cardiovascular, because any of these systems can present as giddiness. So vertigo is a very distressing problem, not only for the patient, but also for the clinician. Why? Because the patient will undergo, like they go to different clinicians, neurologists, cardiologists, ophthalmologists, dental physicians, ENT, a lot of people, and they come up often with normal investigation and futile treatments, they go into a depressed state. The clinician is also in equally difficult position because the patient's symptoms are vague, the clinical tests and investigations are not specific, they come up as normal. And what we resort to is vestibular suppressants. So we overuse these vestibular suppressants. So, and balance disorder, of course, incapacitates the patient. So what is true vertigo? How do we differentiate true vertigo from syncope, disequilibrium, and lightheadedness? So the patient, if they say, I feel faint, I'm giddy, lightheaded, blackouts, all those are syncopes or mere syncope symptoms. So, we have to evaluate the CVS system. Whereas anything to do with the balance, I might fall. So a complete neurological examination is necessary. ENT is usually I'm tilting, rocking, spinning, rotating. Of course, these are all just broad categories that a patient might complain of everything, of which we have to evaluate very, very carefully. I'm just dizzy, very non-specific in these psychiatric disorders, anxiety, depression, etc. So this is just a summary. It can be whatever, brain syncope, disequilibrium, or any other subtypes of disease. So when a patient comes, we just have to ask to ourselves 3 questions. Does the patient really have a balance disorder? If so, is it central or peripheral? And what is the probable etiology? The balance system, as we know, it's awareness of the body position, the brain sensing using visual input, vestibular and proprioceptive input. And how do you find out the answer to these 3 questions is the most important history. So history, we have to ask for the first episode. The patient remembers the first episodes, the duration of the first episode, how it started, how it ended, everything they remember very clearly, rather than the following episodes. We have to also ask for motor sensory history regarding the imbalance, headache, diplopia, drug intake, medical history, trauma history, everything. So history taking is very, very, very important as we got to giddiness and dizziness. And once we found out that it is, whether it is vertigo, is it central or peripheral? So we've ruled out psychiatric and serious causes. So we have to differentiate between central and peripheral. So how is the presentation? Central is imbalance, lightheadedness, disorientation, whereas peripheral is rotating or spinning. All along with nausea and vomiting. Onset here is gradual, whereas peripheral is usually very acute, very sudden. The progress of the disease, the central motion worsens with time, whereas peripheral it actually gradually improves with central compensation. The precipitating factor, there are many precipitating in case of peripheral, like BPPV, turning of head, and fistula, weightlifting or coughing. Whereas central, there are no specific trigger factors. The associated features like diplopia, headache happens in central, whereas in peripheral, it's deafness, tinnitus, vomiting, etc. And systemic disorders, in central, we find diabetes, systemic hypertension, etc. Whereas in peripheral, it's not there. And duration, very important. Symptoms are persistent and progressive, with the exception of TIA and MRV. Whereas peripheral, it's usually single or a recurrent attack, but in between the episodes, the patient is usually free of symptoms. The only exception being motor toxicity, that is progressive. So the duration, again, as in the history taking, is very important. A few seconds is usually a peripheral cause, like acute unilateral loss of vestibular function, or late stages of vestibular uveitis and Meniere's disease. Several seconds to 2 minutes would be BPPV and perineal fistula. And several minutes to even 1 hour is vestibular TIA and perineal fistula. Hours would be Meniere's disease. Hours is Meniere's disease usually from 20 minutes to around 2 hours. Perineal fistula from trauma or surgery can also last hours. Migraine, necrosis, neuroma. Days would be early acute vestibular uveitis. This will last for around 2 to 3 days. This is the only exception in peripheral, because all peripheral usually lasts very less duration, whereas acute vestibular uveitis alone lasts around 2 to 3 days for stroke, migraine, multiple sclerosis. Weeks is usually psychogenic. So what are the peripheral disorders? BPPV, vestibular uveitis, labyrinthitis, Meniere's disease, acoustic neuroma, perineal fistula, vestibular paroxysmia, vestibular concussion, and ototoxicity. To differentiate between all this, history is the most important. Of course, following a clinical examination, investigation, etc. Central would be stroke, TIA, VBS, multiple sclerosis, neurodegenerative disease, migraine, ataxia syndromes, tumors, and epilepsy. So after the history, after we've elicited history, which can even take up to 1 hour for one patient, we have to do the clinical testing of the ear. Whether there is presence of facial paralysis, tuning fork test, neurological tests like for equilibrium, standing test, gait test, Antenberger, Fukuda writing, and finger nose test. Eye movement nystagmus is very, very, very important. In an acute episode, nystagmus is usually present, spontaneous, or at least goes apart. So the plane of the nystagmus, direction and degree is very important. If friends and classes are present, we can see it even better. But even with naked eye, we're supposed to elicit the nystagmus, look at the patient for 2 to 3 minutes to see whether a patient has spontaneous or case evoked nystagmus. This can tell a lot about whether it's central or peripheral, and in peripheral, what kind of disorder the patient has. Positional nystagmus is usually present in BPPV with Dick's Halpeck manoeuvre. Head shaking test, head thrust test is the Hallmark-Kurtz test. This is a very, very, very effective test for VOR. That is the visual vestibular ocular reflex. And this will give a lag period. When we do the head thrusting, there's a lag period which elicits an nystagmus. And this will give a very, very accurate test for the which semicircular canal is involved. And fistula testing using the pneumatic speculum. So the investigation, of course, the ENG, VNG, craniocorporography, VEM, VHIT, PTA, BERA, imaging, everything is done. But not all of these will give positive tests for all patients. We have to be very, very careful in evaluating the results of these tests. I'll just show you the video of this time is... This is a video taken in a VHIT machine, for which there is a very good nystagmus, as you can see, a right, left BT nystagmus, which indicates a right vestibular pathology. A left BT nystagmus indicates a right vestibular pathology. So when such machines are available, VHIT machines, ENGs, which can record, it becomes easier for us to in this, what mismatches is there, what plane direction, etc. So I just go through one or two scenarios. A 40-year-old lady presents with repeated attacks of occasional giddiness, rotatory in nature, with severe nausea but no vomiting, each attack lasting for about 1 minute for the past 3 weeks. The symptoms are induced from turning in the bed, but sometimes even when sitting. This giddiness sensation is described as feeling of sinking and spinning inside the ground. So when someone say, a patient say something like this, we get confused. What is this? Whether it is central or peripheral. So the patient does not have a history of deafness, tinnitus, oral fullness, and has been treated with beta agonist with no relief. So Burton, there is no relief for the patient. And general examination, BP is 100 and 170-100, and here examination is normal. So Dick's halberg is positive for this patient, and this is a posterior canal BPP. Of course, with the Dick's halberg, we can find out whether it's the left or the right side and do at-place maneuver according to that side. Next scenario, 35-year-old male nurse presents with recurrent attacks of giddiness for the past 3 years. Attacks were infrequent initially, but over the last 1 year, have occurred at gradually short intervals. Attacks are accompanied by severe nausea, vomiting, tinnitus, heaviness in the right ear. It's clearly something peripheral. Each attack lasts around 2 hours, but he feels uneasy for the rest of the day. In between each attack, he feels normal, and there's no significant general finding, and ear examination is normal. So all other clinical tests are normal, and it's an inactive phase of Meniere's disease. So whatever we do during the inactive, all tests are normal. So the only way we can find out is history alone. The history of nausea, tinnitus, heaviness in the right ear, everything will indicate. And PTA may or may not be, may not indicate deafness in that particular ear. So this is an inactive phase of Meniere's disease. A 50-year-old male warning driver presents with giddiness, which is rotatory in nature, vomiting, which has started 5 days back, gradually worsening. He also has mild weakness in the lower limb, which affects his driving. Occasionally, there is difficulty in chewing food. His vision is normal, but when looking up, it becomes blurred. He is not diabetic on medication and central control, and general examination normal. No gait abnormality, here is normal. So complete neurological examination should be done because of the lower limb weakness. CT MRI should be done. When the CT MRI was done, lateral medullary syndrome was identified, which is ischemia of the pica. So what are the treatments for various scenarios? There are a lot of treatments. So some are self-limiting. BPPV, most of them are self-limiting. We can treat the underlying cause in case of water toxicity, like stop the drug. And physiotherapy, exercise can be done. Of course, our medical therapy, surgery, and vestibular rehabilitation. But what to give for what patient? So, for Meniere's disease, we usually start with salt restricted diet, diuretics, beta agonists, and then we go for surgery in case none of this works. Vestibular neuritis can be diagnosed by history and by looking at the nystagmus, of which steroids should be started and antivirals should be started. So on the third day, vestibular exercise should be started. Within 1 week, the patient will be near normal. Labyrinthitis, it's antibiotics because of bacterial etiology and vestibular suppressants. But suppressants anyway should be used maximum for 2 to 3 days. That's all. Acoustic neuroma is surgery and stereotactic radiosurgery. Any central cause, of course, antiplatelet therapy, aspirin and pentoxifen can be used. Migraine-related vertigo, a lot of patients come with migraine-related vertigo, which is very, very difficult to diagnose because they complain of headache sometimes, or they complain of no headache sometimes, only vertigo. No headache, only vertigo. It presents very similar to Meniere's, but none of the features of Meniere's are present. So when we do all these examinations, everything is normal. So we might be thinking it's an inactive phase of it, of Meniere's. But probing carefully into the history, we find out that some trigger factors there, whether some food or stress, climate change, something would be there which can be used to diagnose the migraine-related vertigo, for which beta blockers and CCP work out very, very well. Multiple sclerosis, corticosteroids, and interferons. So what is the objective of pharmacotherapy? It provides symptomatic treatment, a palliation to reduce therapy. It increases cerebral and ear blood flow, so it prevents hypoxia, maintains cellular hemostasis and supply of nutrients to neuronal tissues. So beta histin, very widely used, version 14 mg daily dose, histamine analog. What happens is it stimulates the H1 receptors in the blood vessels, local vasodilation, increased permeability. It helps to reverse the underlying problem of the endolymphatic high drops. It blocks the H3 receptors, so local concentration of histamine increases and serotonin also increases, so decreases the activity of the vestibular nuclei. All this is good for 2 to 3 days. That's also Vertin maximum can be used for 2 to 3 days, with exceptions of course. Meniere's disease, we use it for longer periods. What is the ideal antibiotic drug? It selectively increases the acerbal linear in your blood flow, reduces the firing rate in the vestibular nuclei, it's non-sedating and does not necessarily depress the central compensatory mechanism. Side effects of course are bronchial asthma, gastritis. And why should we not use beta-histin? It is indicated in specific diseases like Meniere's disease and 4 to 6 days in acute peripheral disease. Depression is not there, but vestibular depression will delay the ultimate improvement. So use it on the maximum for 4 to 6 days, but I usually use it for 2 to 3 days, that's it. Cinnarizine, again, it's an anticholinergic, it prevents hypoperfusion. And stamatin, propofolazine, it's used in acute vertigo. It's a very nice drug, anti-emetic, CRS inhibitor, depression and inhibitor compensation, again, only for a few days. So what are the 5 C's of medication? It causes sedation, brain of vision, cognitive slowing. These symptoms are felt by the patient as increased dizziness. Tachycardia is another side effect. Anti-emetic cause narcolepsy, extrapyramidal symptoms. So benefits, only the benefits outweigh the risk. So that's why 2 to 3 days. And the role of vestibular rehabilitation cannot be stressed enough. That is more effective than Vertins and Strugenons and Stimitins. So other treatments, of course, surgery and rehabilitation. Rehabilitation is a part of post exercise. This exercise regimen is for 4 to 6 weeks. So it encourages complete compensation of the central nervous system. This needs patient motivation and counseling. It causes the adaptation, habituation and compensation. So the take-home message is, it is important to find whether the patient has true vertigo and whether it is central or peripheral. So thorough history is very important. Relevant clinical testing and investigation should be done. Vertin, Strugenon, Stimitin, best drugs for acute vertigo, and the risk-benefit analysis should be done for the patient. And rehabilitation therapy is the most effective for peripheral vestibular disorders. So it's best to go for rehabilitation therapy. Thank you.
Any questions?
For BPD, benign positional vertigo, what is the duration of cinnarizine or meclizine to be used?
BPD drugs is not effective at all. Shouldn't be used at all. Unless the patient has vomiting. BPD patients rarely have vomiting. They have nausea, but full vomiting is rarely. So proper stamatin can be used for 2 to 3 days. But Vertin and Strugenon has no effect. So only Dixhalbite maneuver, Ebdeis maneuver, for of course the posterior canal BPPV can be used. For lateral canal BPPV and anterior canal, which is very rare, again other maneuvers are there, Kim's maneuver and such.
How long drugs can be used in any condition when you are using? How long these drugs can be used in any condition when you are using?
2 to 3 days, sir, except for Meniere's disease. Meniere's disease.
Just 2 to 3 days.
That's all, sir. Vestibular pneumonitis, suppressants used for 2 to 3 days. Rehabilitation therapy started on the 3rd day. Of course, steroids and antivirals should be continued. That can be continued up to 5 to 6 days, sir. But that's all. 2 to 3 days, except for Meniere's disease. Bilateral vestibulopathy, they say you can use it up to a week.
I have asked this question in many forums, I repeat it again. There are subsector population taking vertigo for years, 3 years, 4 years. How to wean these patients from off their drug?
Yes, sir, I
have seen
my also many patients have been taking for years. So what we should do is first stay for the drugs. I know, like, completely stopping it, the patient will start experiencing psychological withdrawal. So taper the drugs and after that start rehabilitation. Rehabilitation is the only thing that is going to work for them at that stage. Of course, after evaluating his ear balance system, neurological system. It's a set of exercises which has four levels, ma'am. The first level is the eye exercises. Patients are advised to look like this and then like this, gradually increasing the thing for 20 times, and then up and down, and then the head movements, and then the shoulder movements, full body movements. So it's a almost 4-page exercise. But the exercise, if once familiarized, will take maximum 15 minutes. It has to be done twice a day.
Rehabilitation is only exercise.
Only exercise, nothing else. Patient motivation is needed because people doing it for 4 to 6 weeks continuously, 3 times a day, they feel it's very tedious for them. But we have to motivate them saying this is all that is needed.
Okay, no more questions. Once again, I thank Dr. Sindhu and I request Dr. Geeta Sridharan to hand over the certificate of appreciation to Dr. Sindhu. He's a leading ENT surgeon in Ashok Nagar. Thank you.